Good morning. Welcome back. I want to take just a couple minutes to thank a few people and just kind of tell you how appreciative we are as the Rocky Mountain Cyberspace Symposium Committee to have you all here. It's because of you that we're able to do this. We have currently over 2,300 registrants for the show this year, as of right now. We got 36 presenters, 8 speakers, and 5 panels. We have a great lineup set up for you. I'm up here representing the committee, but I'm just merely the chairman. It takes the whole committee that we have, which we'll bring them up later in the show just to get them a round of applause, but we couldn't do it without them, and we can't do it without you guys in the audience here. So thank you very much for everything that you do. I do want to thank VMware for the sponsoring this morning's Continental Breakfast. We also had several training sessions go on yesterday. 8 different companies provided training sessions for us. We had Forescout, VMware, Elastic, GDIT, Nutanix, Google Cloud, Cisco, and F5 provided training classes for over 400 registrants yesterday. And that was all free of charge to those registrants, so hopefully you get to partake in that. And the refreshments were sponsored by Threat Connect. So to kind of get the show rolling, we'll start with our first keynote speaker. He's a 1980-something grad of Purdue. He's the F-16 driver, formerly known as the 24th Air Force Commander and Air Force's cyber. He's a pilot that can actually talk cyber without shooting his watch. So I'd like to bring to the stage the Deputy Commander, Air Combat Command, Lieutenant General Wegman.
Good morning. Or should I say Merry Christmas? Welcome to the jungle, baby. Here we are. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe it is irrefutable that cyberspace is the most heavily contested and congested domain of warfare today. And at the heart of that contest in today's 21st century realm is our data. That is the crown jewel that we, cumulatively, we must protect 24/7, 365 days a year, and we must be relentless in doing so. Look at our jungle. We got China. Yep, our friends. Well, maybe. They are really, really busy. The most prolific nation-state actor in cyber attacks focused primarily on intellectual property theft. They are stealing our national competitive advantage every day. Then we go over across the road to North Korea. North Korea, you know, not a lot there, but we know they have a demonstrated will to act and do malicious and destructive activities in, from, and through the cyber domain. They are also keeping their regime alive through cyber-based hacking of banks and cryptocurrency exchanges. And last year alone, it's estimated they netted in their heists $3 billion in hard currency and crypto exchange currency on 35 attacks in 17 different countries. Not necessarily a sleepy little hollow in North Korea, is it? Then we go down to Mother Russia. Yep, another friend. Well, not really. As we know, this is one of the most capable adversaries out there. They are continuing to take on U.S. critical infrastructure targets and doing their own target development, if you will, and trying to attack those infrastructures. They are very, very prolific in the information confrontation space, in the social media realms, and of course, there are all their pursuits in our election and in our democratic processes. And then we go over to Iran. Another sleepy hollow, right? No, they're really, really busy. What are they going against? Again, gas and oil sector specifically. And they are also hard at work trying to help take down some of the military pursuits we have going on in their backyard. And the one other thing I would be remiss if I didn't mention about Russia that has occurred, and many of you may have read the article in Wired written by Andrew Greenberg. It's another sandworm derivative. But one of the things Russia did at the Seoul Olympics and their Olympic destroyer cyber exploits is they raised the game completely in what we would all call false flag obfuscation. Who did it? Was it China? Was it North Korea? Was it Iran? Was it Russia? Man, if you follow that bouncing ball, it took us a long, long time to figure it out. And here are a few other cool stats for us to think about the jungle. Supply chain attacks were up 78% in 2019. So we got that going for us. Cloud customers endured 681 million cyber attacks in 2018 alone. And then, of course, we have one thing that's not on my slide, which is ransomware. Every 14 seconds, there's a ransomware attack going on in the United States. So since I've come on the stage, there's probably been 8 or 10 of them. And they're going after business and operational data now. And if you've been keeping up with current events, you saw an example. They're going against our municipalities. New Orleans was a great example where the mayor had to declare a state of emergency. 3,400 computers, $3 million to remediate that. And so ransomware is definitely a big threat for us. So what's going on in our jungle is there is a definite increase in scope, scale, and sophistication of our adversaries every day, 24/7 a day. Welcome to the jungle. So with that wonderful stage set, what I want to do today is talk a little bit about data superiority and the data superiority imperative in the 21st century. I want to talk about kind of what we did in Headquarters Air Combat Command in our Air Force to create decision advantage in 2019, provide kind of an update on the Advanced Battle Management System and our contribution to Joint All-Domain Command and Control. And then I want to pivot into 2020 and offer you a glimpse into some of the great opportunities and challenges that are available to us to pursue and conquer together. And then I'll end with my own personal perspectives on what we need to do together to continue to succeed in, from, and through the cyberspace and electromagnetic spectrum domains. And I hope I don't suck. All right, data. I believe without data superiority, you lose. And I believe that data superiority imperative is what drives us and forces us, if not compels us, to answer three specific questions moving forward. First and foremost, what do we need our data to do for us? It starts with the operational imperatives, the mission, the operators. What problems do they need the data to do? Which means we have to effectively prioritize the application of resources and policy and human capital to answer those questions. Once we figured that out, we got to get to the technology side of it all. That was the mission side. On the technology side, we got to figure out, how do we make the data do what's required? What's the hardware, firmware, software? What kind of data engineers, data scientists, artificial intelligence, machine learning, virtual and augmented realities? How do we get the data to do what's required? And this is a really, really challenging space. And once we figure that out, then we go to the best part of it all, which is the august, bold, and audacious cyber airman, soldier, sailor, marine, and Coast Guardsman in the loop that is sitting there doing battle management and command and control with the things we present them so they have speed, agility, and precision in action across the spectrum of conflict. Those three questions we have to answer, and we have to answer them continuously and relentlessly. I was recently reading a Joint Force Headquarters, joint cyber publication, and that the banner in the middle of the slide came out in this one article I read, which is, you know, how do you describe today's data environment? And I think it's really important to understand kind of the contextually, what is the environment we're operating in so we understand our contemporary operating environment. And what it said is, you know, the first thing is everything is social, mobile, and local. All of our data, social, mobile, and local. Social means the prolific social media, which is all those privately owned public spaces that are out there. We are all spewing our digital exhaust all over the place, which just makes social engineering of us from spear phishing attacks and all that much easier, right? It's all mobile. It means we take our data with us wherever we go. It's on our watch, it's in our phones, it's in our cars. Mobile, full up. And local. What they're getting at in local, what the authors were getting at, is basically all the data that we do, all the things we do, is fundamentally geotagged. Just like all of you sitting right here, right now. Guarantee you that's being tracked. Next thing is that data is useless without data science. Football analogy, right? Can you imagine an NFL football team without a training camp, a coaching staff, or a playbook? Well, that's the Miami Dolphins, but, oh, wow, come on. It's the Dolphins. I mean, they didn't show up all season. So the next thing is IT solutions are customized and intuitive. This is, indeed, there is an app for that. And so as private citizens, we're pretty used to customized and intuitive apps that have customer service, that are constantly evolving, that are updated, that are patched, that are secure, right? Now put on your uniform and sit in your desk at DoD, and so how much do we think our business is intelligent? I think we have a big gap to close there. And the last one is that the internet is everywhere, right? From cloud to edge, from subsurface to space, no matter where you sit on the planet today, if you have the means, we can get the data to you anywhere, anytime. So that's pretty powerful. It's a pretty powerful environment for us from a data perspective. So if we seek to fly, fight, and win as the United States Air Force, United States Space Force, in airspace and cyberspace, we must assure and secure data superiority. Okay, so let's take a look at 2019. In 2019, Headquarters Air Combat Command and our great United States Air Force was really, really busy getting after creating decision and action advantages for our forces abroad. If we think of 21st century information warfare in the frame of a revolution of military affairs, then there are four core competencies, or four things we need to do and put on the board as an Air Force and a Space Force to succeed. Revolution in military affairs. We need organization, we need doctrine, we need people trained, the human wetware in the loop, and we need technology, some types of widgets that are creating and enabling the revolution. On this slide, I've produced four things that we've started upon and are moving out on in 2019 to give us that revolution in military affairs for information warfare. Let's take a look at them. All right, so in October 2019, the United States Air Force in San Antonio, Texas, many of you were there, right? We activated 16th Air Force. The Air Force's first information warfare numbered Air Force. So this is the organization that is required for our RMA moving forward. This was, for those of you that are old enough, this was that Wonder Twin Powers moment, where the two rings came together and was Wonder Twin Powers activate, form of, an information warfare NAF. Kind of anticlimactic. But right then and there, 16th Air Force, a rising phoenix, was born. And since then, they've been really, really busy getting after it, what they need to do. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a really busy slide. We're gonna have to give our CAG some Ritalin so they don't put so much information on slides. What I would draw your attention to is the big arrow is pointing to eight things that we seek to achieve, eight organizational and operational outcomes that 16th Air Force has put on the board and is working diligently to achieve. Some of them are already at initial operational capability, and some of them will take years or months, if not years, to attain. They've only been at this for 5 months. And so they're integrating, they're storming and forming, and the phoenix is rising. And as Lieutenant General Tim Hawk will tell you probably on Thursday, you'll probably hear a little bit about Rise Up, and it's amazing to watch. What I would offer what's going on down in San Antonio is there is a human capital dream team now put together that has immense power, immense capability and capacity to generate decisive decision and action advantages across the spectrum of conflict in this new information warfare organization. It is a really, really exciting time for our great Department of Defense with 16th Air Force on the map. And I don't want to steal a lot more thunder because I know Lieutenant General Hawk will be here on Thursday, and I hope you're here to see him go into a deeper dive on what 16th Air Force is doing for us. Okay, we talked about organization, let's talk about people. One of the things that Air Combat Command did in coordination with the Headquarters Air Force and our new A26, so the Director of Intelligence, Surveillance, Reconnaissance, and Cyber Effects Operations, one of the things we put out this year was a warfare force development flight plan, which basically gave us a deliberate plan for how we're going to train, educate, and develop cyber warfare officers in the United States Air Force. This was great because this gives us highly specialized and highly proficient cyber warfare officers across all of our core mission areas. something we didn't have before. We used to use a phrase about a very homogenous workforce and phrases like perpetual amateurism, not in a pejorative way, just in that we are sub-optimized in the way we are trying to deliver and cultivate our human capital. There are two career fields in the new plan, in the new career field development plan. First is the cyber effects officers, and the second one is the warfighting communication operations officers. Each one of those has two tracks. In the cyber effects officers, we have offensive cyber operators and defensive cyber operators. And on the warfighting communications, we have network operations, and we have expeditionary communications, or the formerly known as combat comm, which is a realm dominated by the august Air Reserve Component Warriors, Cyber Jedis. Rufy, there he is. All right, had to get that out. It's like a nickel in my hat right there. So this is really powerful, and we're moving out. And what we're working on now is working with the Air Staff to develop the training and education flight plans that will cultivate and grow these august warriors for us moving forward. So that's a little bit on the personnel initiatives. I think I have one more on personnel. Okay, just like cyberspace warfare officers need to be deliberately developed, so too do multi-domain warfare officers. And so that's why the Air Force and our Chief of Staff, General Goldfleet, decided we need to deliberately train, educate, and develop multi-domain warfare officers for the United States Air Force so they can underpin and gird and provide battle management and command and control for joint all-domain command and control moving forward. So as you can see here, the key thing we were trying to change in the Air Force is that battle management and command and control, the way we were assigning airmen and civilians to do that, it was like a staff job. Hey, here's a 90-day TDY, please go over here and work in an AOC and do operational warfighting missions called battle management and command and control. No, it's not a staff function, it's a warfighting function. It's a warfighting imperative. And so that's hence the 13 Oscar career field was born. And the current framework is where we take current officers that are steeped in their career field tracks and in some discipline. At the 7 to 12 year career field, we then transfer them. When they say, send me, I'll go, we send them to the 505th Combat Control Wing in Hurlburt, and they go through a long class, and they come out rebranded as 13 Oscars. And then they move forward and we assign them to all of our air operations, space operations, and cyber operations component commands. And they're trying now to cultivate the new brand, multi-domain operation, multi-domain warfare officers, right? Integrate to dominate is what I left them, because I had the honor to officiate the first inaugural graduation, where 27 multi-domain warfare officers were minted, to include 7 initial cadre instructors that stayed behind at Hurlburt. Exciting times. One of the things for your essay that we're talking about right now is that we're not convinced that this career field pyramid is optimum because it constrains how many domains someone gets smart in to be a multi-domain. You probably get steeped in one domain for 7 to 10 years and then maybe have time for another one or another two. So what we're looking at is, do we want to assess these people right in at commissioning source into a multi-domain officer career track and then apply an apprentice, journeyman, master kind of mindset? Or if you think in the medical world, internships, right? We send them to an air component headquarters for a few months. We send them to a space component, to a land component, to a maritime component. And we grow them all the way up from accession all through their formative years into their adulthood as multi-domain warfare officers. One of the highlights of my time there was their patch, which is Oscar the Grouch sitting on the Iron Throne. First of their name. All they're missing is a t-shirt that says, I battle manage and I know things. And if you haven't watched Game of Thrones, what are you doing? Okay, the last thing we did, one of the big Herculean lifts of 2019 for us as an Air Force and as a joint force really, was multi-domain operations, the advanced battle management system, and within the joint all-domain command and control strategy. So this is that, you know, Rubik's Cube that kind of perplexes people. So if, like me, you believe that strategy is a plan for the application of resources to achieve stated aims, let me break this down for you. The end state, our stated aim, is joint all-domain command and control. Multi-domain operations is the ways we're going to get there. An advanced battle management system is the means. And really, it's the Internet of Things we're going to use to underpin the whole thing. But if you want to conduct multi-domain operations inside the broader joint all-domain command and control footprint, you have to generate four things. The first thing you have to generate is problems, problems in and from every domain, from every service and every partner we have. The second thing is what I call domain interdependence, where these things have to be reinforcing across domains so that we have interoperability, but more importantly, interdependence. Third is capability integration. That's at the platform level and at the data level. We're really good at the former. We got to get a lot better at the latter. And the last thing you need is tempo, or what I call operationally relevant velocity, so that we can conduct and we can present adversaries multiple dilemmas from all domains at a tempo that they can't match. And that's kind of the bumper sticker for joint all-domain command and control. So what are the foundational capabilities that make up joint all-domain command and control? So I'm gonna walk around this slide kind of clockwise to help us all kind of get a grip. There are four foundational core capabilities that underpin and gird joint all-domain command and control. The first is a sensing grid, which connects every sensor to every shooter, but it's all sensors from all countries, all technologies, all trying to generate insights and data sets that allow us to do the command and control required. And then that sensor data goes into an advanced networking grid. The advanced networking grid is all classification levels. It's data-centric, so it's focusing on data security at rest, data security in transit. I already mentioned multi-level security. It's gonna use redundant and resilient transport so that we're leveraging over IP, fiber, space, free space optical, 5G mesh, all the multi-phenomenology sets that are out there for what we wanna do to get data to the point of need. And that's a really cool advanced network, and I'll show you how we've actually kind of put one together recently. And then we wanna apply state-of-the-art artificial intelligence and machine learning to the data so that our battle managers and our commanders can have speed, agility, precision, and generate the military outcomes that we need. And finally, the coolest part is where we put the august cyber warrior or multi-domain officer warrior in the loop to now battle manage and command and control all the information they have so that we can generate decisive options and decisive outcomes across the spectrum of conflict 24/7, 365. And of course, ladies and gentlemen, at the center of all this is the digital DNA that underpins everything in 21st century warfare, and that is data. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that. So that's kind of the foundation that is joint all-domain command and control. Now let's get into the actual Internet of Things that makes it up. So the Advanced Battle Management System is basically a digital engineered architecture that delivers multi-domain operations within the joint all-domain command control framework. And this is literally the architecture that we have put online now with Preston Dunlap, our lead architect, working that. And so there are six core functions and capabilities that are here on the slide, labeled 1 through 6, all premised on a digital engineered foundation with a shared set of standards or a family of standards that are open so we can do that. And as you can see, it goes all the way from sensing to data processing all the way out to battle management. These six core functions, within each box, you have a list of something labeled blank one. These are our capability product lines that are actually delivering that digital function for whatever mission operation we're trying to execute. These product lines, I think there's 27 of them actually now, they're going out to California this week to determine who will be the champions that will actually lead the development of these product lines. Ladies and gentlemen, this exists today. This is online, it's in the green. We actually did an experiment, I'll show you here, recently down in Eglin in December, which put it all together. And for those of you, one is the moniker or the brand we're using, and so we call this the Fitbone slide. Fill in the blank one. So whenever you see this, you can say, hey, Fitbone, and you'll be all set. So how do we take this from the drawing board to the battle lab? How do we make it real? It's pretty simple. On this slide, what we did is we started with doctrine and concepts, wargaming, conops development, then we pulled it in through functional mission analysis, which many of you in this room understand how we do that, to what are the digital core capabilities we need to do those missions, functions, and tasks. And then once we knew that, we put it into the battle lab, and we started experimenting with real hardware and software in the loop in a DevSecOps agile environment that is an open architecture with cumulative leave-behind capabilities, integrating capabilities and doing this fast. And when I say fast, we're doing 4-month sprints right now with the capabilities we're trying to do. So it's kind of a three-legged stool, right? We're going concept to digital architecture capability to product development in an agile, fast-moving ship. And then finally, how do you make JADC2 real? This is where Dr. Frankenstein starts to get giddy, right? It's alive! I just want to see if you're still awake. I mean, I am talking about JADC2. Whew! And so what we're doing now is we're having these 4-month sprints. We just had an exercise down at Eglin Air Force Base in December where we take combatant commanders who give us mission threads and problems to solve, and we go down there and we put all this together. We put an air battle or advanced battle management system in our technical architecture underneath it. That's that Internet of Things that connects it, and we actually see, can we deliver this in real-world operationally relevant outcomes? And we're doing this fast, and we're learning fast, and we're failing fast, and we're actually leaving capability behind after each 4-month iteration. This is the first one we did. They actually did 2 experiments. I'm just showing you one right now. This is called ABMS OnRap 1. The scenario was, how do we find and maintain custody of a cruise missile launcher from where it was in garrison, where it was fixed, based on what we needed to do, and then all the way through transit to its launch location. And then can we use a multi-collaborative sensing grid of joint fires to actually take it out? And so this is exactly what happened. This is real. Everything that has a green circle by it in terms of the advanced battle management system worked as defined. We were able to connect the grid. We were able to use the Data One unified data library that formerly Air Force Space Command, United States Space Force now, put together for us. It was able to allow people to put data in and take data out across multi-domains from the air layer, the space layer, and the maritime layer, which was really cool. We used commercial partners. We had commercial LEO from Starlink, which is a SpaceX prolific commercial LEO satellite constellation. We also had Anduril technology helping us to create a mesh network in the ground layer, as well as helping us do artificial intelligence-enabled combat ID when we did the second experiment. So it was a big hit. And ultimately, we were able to close the kill chain, either from a Navy DDG, from an Army HIMARS, from an Air Force F-22 and or F-35, and we had a direct action soft force on the ground as well. Ladies and gentlemen, we are running with scissors here. And we put this together, and this is not PowerPoint, this was real. There were some hiccups and some burps, but all in all, it was amazing. And by the way, it was attended by the Deputy Secretary of Defense and high-level GOs from every service. The next event is taking place in April, and we look forward to that. So, 2019, we got some stuff done. So y'all should take a bow for that. I'm really, really proud, and it's just an absolute privilege to work with such great, great Americans every day. So let's talk about 2020. Happy New Year. That's me on the left there, by the way. I'm the guy that keeps clicking on the links. It's not good. So I believe 2020 is going to bring us a lot of opportunities and a lot of challenges. So I stole a couple of slides out from that intranet space using the Google. So here's Gartner's top 10 strategic trends. What excites me about this slide is the mission-oriented innovation space that's here. It's the stuff that I wrote down, those are my chicken scratch on the right, on the DoD applications to some of these tech trends. And as your eyes kind of wander and you read through it, I'm going to highlight my top three, well, because I can. I have the clicker. So the three things that give me the greatest, opportunity on this one are the democratization of expertise, which will help us get better at DevSecOps, help our developer workforce, and also our data science. What does that mean? It means smart tools are helping us be smarter without getting PhDs in data science and data engineering. For those of you in the room, it's a great example is Jupyter Notebooks, right? The Python, the R, whatever, all that shit's, stuff's running in the background. They'll bleep that out, right? All that stuff's running in the background. So you run your analytic, it's all good, and you share it at GitHub, and you go, and you're not a PhD data scientist. You may even be kind of, at Python. It's okay. It does it for you. It's like, it's built for me. The fighter pilot, the simple tool, it's amazing. So the next thing I think is this really, really powerful is the empowered edge. Remember the cloud craze, and then into the fog, and now we're at the edge. And now you got like Qualcomm Snapdragon chips that'll just basically, it's like a little cloud on your watch. We got, you know, containerization. We got hyper-convergence of infrastructure. And so we're worried about the EMS spectrum and being contested and denied environments. This empowered edge is going to get us through disconnected places. It's going to get us through the need to fly carrier pigeons to get orders out. We can do it for agile combat employment. We can work with 5G, whether it's sub-6 or higher, millimeter wave. And we can work with commercial LEO. I mean, we're going to get the data where it needs to get. And this empowered edge is empowering. And the last thing that I think is really powerful on here is AI security. I think there's both offensive and defensive capabilities and mission assurance there. And we have to get serious about how do we want to secure the data. So lots of opportunity there. But I'd be remiss if I didn't go take us to the dark side of the force. So you got to go light and dark. This is Greg, I don't know if Greg's here, the CSO from Palo Alto. I enjoyed reading this. I think these are all things we kind of deal with already, but these are big threats, and these, the level of sophistication here is daunting. So I need you all up in your game. So what are my top three on this slide? You probably all thought I was going to go for fakes and deep fakes. Yeah, that's scary. We got to know how to detect them. Have you been reading about the audio deep fakes now? How'd you like to be able to get someone that sounds just like your warfighting commander that is the authorities to deliver fires and get a phone call from someone that sounds just like him? Okay, but that's not my top three. So my top three are supply chain attacks. Remember, up 78% in 2019. That's scary because we are a highly technology-driven force that likes to build things all the time. The second thing is cloud incident response tools and skills. You know, we have to get access to the data to be able to respond, first of all. Have we rehearsed the plans? Do we have pre-scripted actions we want to take? Do we have the right tools? Can we work both in a multi-cloud strategy and a hybrid cloud architecture? 681 million attacks last year in the cloud customers. Clouds for us are strategic centers of gravity. So I'm really, really, we got to get serious about that, and we got to make sure we know how to respond. And we need speed, agility, precision, right, in response. And the last thing, again, is AI and ML. Artificial intelligence, that's great. It's great, but it's narrow. And if you just think of the concept of perpetual novelty, it's not too hard to fake out. And then you have the immense amount of code that is used, right, to do all that, the algorithms, right, the backpropagation, deep neural networks, millions of lines of code where you can just do basic code exploits and start messing with AI. And we haven't even talked about the training data. How do you make sure you have data provenance and so that you know what the data is being trained in or trained, the algorithm is being trained on? And of course, we have all the concerns about bias. And so there's a lot of work ahead in both AI and ML from a cybersecurity perspective. I had a gentleman in my office to show me some examples of how they were fooling machine vision with these things called patches. It's not a patch you put on here, it's just a patch you put on something that says, well, that's a raptor. And it says, no, it's a squirrel. You go, oh, I don't shoot squirrels down. I like squirrels. So, different problem. Okay. So, what I want to do now is give you what I think are my personal perspectives on the things we need to do, success imperatives moving forward, to continue our momentum in 2020 and beyond. First and foremost, we need velocity in all things. But velocity has two components, right? It's like a vector, speed and a direction. That's why this used to say speed, but now it says velocity, because I don't want to go really fast solving the wrong problems. I want us to make sure that in all parts of the OODA loop, observe, orient, decide, and act, that we can get after that faster. We need to be able to recruit and retain the workforce we need faster. We need to do threat detection, response, and mitigation faster. We need to preserve our momentum, and we have to learn to do it faster and prioritized on the right things. We need to maintain our operational velocity. Our value proposition, our street cred as a domain of as operational warfighters in an operational warfighting domain requires us to deliver outcome-driven institutional value. This is an existential reality for cyberspace operations and all the services. Put up or shut up. Deliver outcomes that matter. If you are a classic warfighting person, you value operational outcomes. Deny, degrade, deceive, disrupt, destroy. These are confrontations of warriors. These are what give you institutional value, earns you credibility, which gives you respect and trust. And with that trust comes resources and buy-in. And so the challenge is there. We all have to work on outcome-driven institutional value. We need to work harder at aligning responsibilities, authorities, and resources into a single organization or a single person so we can get after velocity and those operational outcomes. We are not good at unified action. We have a 20th century human capital management organization, and our organizational design in the United States Air Force, at least, is decades old, and it is a relic of a bygone era. Three glaring examples right in front of us for unified action. Information warfare workforce, 16th Air Force is our attempt to try and unify action for that. Second is DevSecOps and the agile craze, right? Our software renaissance. It's stovepipe fundamentally in the acquisition community. But what we need to do is think about a squadron, if you will, in an Air Force lexicon, where you have operator, engineer, developer, contractor, with a commander that has authorities and resources all aligned to deliver the product outcomes, the MVPs they need to execute that squadron's mission. How powerful and how fast would that be? Right now, they're all in four different functional lanes, in three different major commands in the United States Air Force. And we're working well, but it's suboptimum. And the last one, in my good friend Bill Marion's summary here, I'm trying to help him here, is enterprise IT as a service, right? Multi-stakeholder paralysis. I mean, it's not, but think about it. You got the SAFCN, SAFCIO, Secretary, you got the DOD CIO, you got DISA, you got 16th Air Force, you got Air Combat Command, you got LCMC, Air Force Material Command, and I probably left out six other organizations with their hands in that pot. The resources are spread out as well as are the authorities and responsibilities. So Bill is negotiating that. It's his own jungle, and he's living it every day. And I'm glad we have him up there on that wall in that jungle. I believe in the 21st century, the data superiority is an operational center of gravity for us in all the services. We got to get serious about our data. And if you believe the AI craze and AI washing everything and having lightning bolts have been replaced by AI on slides because that's going to solve all our problems, well, if you want to be a leader in artificial intelligence and machine learning, you better be a leader in data first. We got to get after it. And I like to see, I like what I'm seeing, but there's a lot more work to be done here. Partnerships. 96% of our hardware and software we operate as the Department of Defense every day comes from you all, the private sector. These are commercial products for the most part. So of course we have to partner with you. But I'm not as interested in your technology as I am into your learning, your insights, your lessons learned, and partnering together to get after solving hard problems that our nation expects of the Department of Defense. We need you. We can't do it without you. And for those naysayers out there that like to talk about the divergence between our mission value imperative and your profit motive, I tell them to shut it. Just shut it. Because what I'm talking about is a partnership that is founded on a shared core values. You know, these are values like freedom, national security, our inalienable rights to life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. That's what everyone in this room gets. That's what makes us get up in the morning. That's what's important to us. That's what we value. And in that realm, partnerships flourish. In all things. We got to get relentless about increasing the diversity in all things, from human capital to hardware. This is the one success imperative that buoys all the other ones that I just talked about. It is the rising tide that will lift all boats. And standing before you today, I'm actually, I believe, an example of it. I hope it's a positive example. They took a knuckle-dragging 25-year Neanderthal fighter pilot and said, hey, you're an operational warfighter, you get warfighting. Go try and blend in with the cyber tribe. Well, I think I brought a perspective, insights, experience that hopefully added value. So I am a walking example of that type of tribal diversity for all of us to think about. We need warriors proficient in battle management. We cannot let technology blind us and the love affair with technology blind us to the fact that there are humans in the loop doing this. And we have to train warfighters that are proficient at that. Because, ladies and gentlemen, the courageous men and women in the loop, they are the ones that bear the burden of victory for us as a nation. Don't ever forget that we have to train our human capital to get the job done. So, never forget, you matter most. I've said it many times. In cyberspace superiority, the most critical element is not silicon, it's not carbon, or it's not copper, it's carbon. It's the bold and audacious American soldier, sailor, airman, marine, and civilian that gets after it every day. And I need you to be bold, I need you to be audacious, I need you on that wall. I want you on that wall. And in cyber, I want you over that wall, all up in the grill of the adversary, dominating every day. And remember, in our profession, in fighting and winning your nation's wars, losing's just not an option. So, we got to get to work. And I'll close by saying, remember, the lion earns its trust, its value, and its honor in the jungle. Thank you. That's it. I don't know if I had time for questions. I don't know, okay. Oh, I didn't, if my time was perfect, there'd be no time. Happy to try and answer whatever questions you might have.
Joe Wagner, sir.
Uh-oh, John. No, that's a great question. I think I kind of covered it a little bit. You know, we need outcome-driven institutional value, and that's what we need. So we have to actually demonstrate. So we have to do our targeting process, and we have to figure out how do we get access with platform access and tools to targets that where we can hold them at risk, just like in any other domain. And so we don't need any new gadgets or any new concepts or doctrine. Joint targeting is joint targeting. If an airplane can hold a target at risk from the air and we can hold that same target at risk in from and through cyberspace, then we're going to get institutional value and we're going to get offered that opportunity because maybe we can save and we can reduce risk to mission and risk to force because we are action at distance and we're typically humans out of the loop, depending on if we need close access teams to help us get to the target. So we got to get targets on the board. We have to be able to say, I can offer you an outcome to strike that target, sir or ma'am. When you do that, you get credibility, you get trust, and you also get resources, which is why I think what you just described, John, is the existential reality and threat for us. If we are too slow and we can't get there, then we will be left behind from a cyber fire maneuvering effects taking the place of a kinetic bomb, missile, or bullet. Great, great question. What else?
Hello?
Sir.
Scott, I'm from Triple C. Got a question for you. Love the way you're driving. I'm inspired every day listening and looking at the innovative Air Force sites. How do we get after the frozen middle?
Well, blowtorch works. You know, the frozen middle, I think there was some there. But I think there's also a little urban legend there, and it may do a disservice to a lot of hard-working people that are just trying to do what someone told them they need to do. So I think, again, the way we get the frozen middle is diversity, right? You got a new day, new jet. We got to bring in new talent, new minds, new perspectives. And I think right now we have a perfect storm. I think we have to be carpe diem. When I look at the leadership we have in the Air Force, you know, we got Mr. Marion, we got General Kreider here, who's one of our data thought leaders and actors, actually. You got Preston Dunlap, you got Dr. Roper, you got Lauren Knossenberger, you got Nick Chalane, and we got people running with scissors. And they're not waiting. We're having this champion flip the script event out in LA. So I think all of that is slowly going to dissolve the frozen middle, because what's going to happen is we're just going right over them. I ask you all to help with that. Obviously there's some operational rigor and discipline that's required for us, because there's oversight and we spend a lot of money really fast. So there's a little bit of frost. It's always there. All right. I think that's it. Thanks, y'all. I look forward to engaging with you throughout the day and the week.
General, on behalf of the Rocky Mountain chapter, I just want to say thank you very much for sharing your time and experience with us today. It's
awesome.
Always good, and pleasure to always have you here.
Thanks.
You
appreciate
very
it.
Much, sir.
Peace.
Okay, I have my first public service announcement of the day. If you drove here in a Subaru Forester, Colorado Tag, Alpha, Bravo, Yankee, Whiskey 2-1, your lights are on. So if you're not running out to save your battery right now, I would invite you to please take a break, sponsored by Avaya. And at 9:45, we will resume in here with our first panel by Mr. Bill Marion, talking about a paradigm shift in cybersecurity. So see you at 9:45. Thank you.